From the Sunshine State, this is Tampa Bay's 10 Talk.
Welcome to Picture This, Tampa Bay's only call-in talk show devoted exclusively to photography, hosted by myself, Lou Donald, and Jeff Donald.
Hey, Lou. How are you this evening?
Good. Good. How are you? Raining a little bit, but we're dry inside.
Yeah, we're dry and warm in the WTAN studios here in beautiful downtown Clearwater. And since we got that far where we're at, let's do a few phone numbers. Welcome to call in with your questions, anything photographic. Lou and I will field your questions in Pinellas County. Call us at 727-441-3000 or toll free 866-826-1340 or catch us streaming on the web. You can do that on the WTAN Talk website, http://tantalk1340.com, et cetera, et cetera. You'll figure it out. Google Tantalk.
And you can also get us picturethis.questions at gmail.com, and you can email questions as well.
Yep, yep. All righty. So, Lou, what did you do this weekend? Big holiday weekend? Anything exciting?
Pretty quiet.
Oh, really?
Pretty quiet. We're thinking about doing fireworks, but quite honestly, didn't feel like getting wet.
Yeah, it has been kind of the monsoon season here, as we all look out the radio. See if the antenna gets hit by lightning tonight, you know. Whoa, Cedric. So anyway, let's see here. You've got a website of the week, which kind of builds on last week.
Last week, we talked a lot about a photograph that had been rejected.
Disqualified
is the right word,
yep.
Yes. In a landscape photography contest in Great Britain, and we talked was rejected or disqualified because of too much use of Photoshop or some type of software.
Yep.
And I incorrectly credited that photo to Simon Butterworth.
Right.
On SimonButterworthPhotography.com.
Right.
And in fact, he was the photographer that they awarded the prize to after they disqualified a photographer by the name of David Byrne.
Sure.
David Byrne's photograph can be seen on his website, which is the website for today,
right,
which is the numbers 85mm.co.uk.
Okay.
He has galleries up there and specific types of photographs that you can look up. He's also a website designer. Very, very interesting photographs, his black and whites. His photograph of two boats in Lindisfarne Castle,
okay,
was the image that was disqualified.
Right.
But some wonderful images that he has. Highly recommend spending a little time. He's got a lot of images up and a lot of different types of photography, not just as black and white landscapes.
Cool. And I will lead into our discussion tonight in a little bit, but you and I were talking about this. We talked about it at our coffee on Wednesday at O'Keefe's in Clearwater, which is the Canon this past Monday announced a new camera kind of in there, what we might have called or call their prosumer. It's a higher end. It's not an introductory camera, and the price tag reflects it. You can get the body for like $1,200, $1,199, and with a lens for another $100 more. So, but it is the new Canon EOS 70D, and that's kind of interesting because as we were talking before the show, you were stating how that it's really changing in that You know, in a 4 year period, the camera that it's replacing, the 60D, I guess it's probably about 3 years old, and it only went from 18 megapixels to 20. And what were your thoughts on that?
Well, it's very, very different than when digital photography the first 3 or 4 years, where as new cameras came out, the megapixels jumped drastically.
Right.
And if you wanted to keep up, you had to go out and buy the new model, and the one that it replaces, the 60D,
sure,
was probably 18 megapixels,
yeah, yeah,
and this one is around 20 megapixels.
Yep, exactly.
So if I had a 16D, I'm not so sure. The other areas of the camera are where you're tending to see some big improvements these days.
Right.
One of the big criticisms of the 60D was its autofocus.
Right.
It only had like 11 autofocus points.
Yeah,
people
maybe even
felt,
nine. Yeah,
yeah, maybe yep, even nine. People felt that for that kind of price, they should be have a more advanced autofocus system with more points. And this one's up to, I think, around 19 autofocus
yep, 19.
Points. So there's you can see an improvement there. A new autofocus system.
Right.
Which should help make it faster.
Right. But truthfully, the bulk of the autofocus system is really the people that are going to notice the biggest improvements and are people who shoot video with their cameras. And I think a lot of people, you tend to fall into one camp or the other. You're either a still shooter and it happens to have video, or you're a video videographer, video person, and oh gee, my camera happens to take still photos. You know, they've started adding that video feature in. You know, only in the last 6-7 years, really, if even that long. And you know, those two are blending, whether the users want it or not.
Right.
And the reality of it is it's not hard for the manufacturers to build those features in with a little modifications to firmware and software and computer chips, and it's easy enough to do. But this should be an interesting camera. It comes in at a good price point, competes quite favorably with the Nikon 7100. So we'll see what happens. But there was another thing. I didn't even mention this to you this week. This came across my Twitter account. I follow a pretty well-known photographer by the name of Trey Ratcliffe.
Mm-hmm.
And he's probably the biggest proponent, best well-known HDR photographer in the world today. And he runs a travel website called StuckInCustoms.com. Huge, huge website. Lots of great photography and some information, some books. There's links to it from our site. Stuck in Customs and the Trey Ratcliffe stuff. But he announced this week that he moved away from Nikon. He had been shooting a D800, 36 megapixel. You know, he's mostly a landscape with people in landscape, but not really a portrait guy. Mostly landscapes, cityscapes, what I call urban landscapes. And he announced that he was giving up his Nikon stuff, going full Sony mirrorless.
Really?
The next 7. At the NEX7. And he's been an early proponent of non-DSLRs. He really likes the mirrorless based on size, weight, and of course, I mean, he travels, but
yep.
I don't think he's a real light traveler, so to speak.
Doesn't sound like it.
And, you know, and so right away the buzz was, oh, Sony paid him off.
Yeah.
Sony bought all this stuff. So he posted back on Twitter that no, actually not, that Sony had offered. After he tried the camera himself and wrote a favorable blog on it, Sony offered to buy him, just give him a whole system. And he said no. And he bought his own system. He said, you know, I've got all the receipts for it if anybody really wants to know. But no, I didn't let Sony do this. And so that's kind of interesting that, you know, we're now in an era where a lot of people that own DSLRs probably don't need to own DSLRs. They could go with smaller, lighter cameras, anywhere from the Micro Four Thirds to the Nexus and all of those, and be better served. They'd be more compact, lighter weight, and minimal loss of image quality, if any.
I, in many ways, agree with that. You know, yep. I read an article in Shutterbug a few months ago.
Right.
And I'm trying to remember the name of the guy. Maynard Switzer
is
a travel photographer that writes for them.
Yep.
And he was talking that he had bought a mirrorless camera and was taking it on his next trip.
Right. And you're starting to see that where, and I think it's reflected in that the maturity of these products where, like you pointed out, manufacturers in the early days of digital, 10, 12 years ago, every 6 months new point-and-shoots were out. Every year there was a new, you know, DSLR that doubled the resolution. And we're just not seeing that anymore. And do people really need that? And the manufacturers, I'm sure, are seeing it as well in their sales numbers that we can't provide enough reason for them to upgrade. So they're hanging on to their cameras longer. My last camera, I bought it 4 years ago this September, which was the Canon 7D. I'm still waiting for a replacement for that, and we're 4 years in on it, or almost 4 years. So we'll see. Interesting times for sure. But this week in photo history is kind of going to lead into our topic for the evening. This week in history on, got to pull up the exact date. July 5th, 1833. So that would be, what, 180 years ago. A French inventor passed away, Nicéphore Niépce. And you're probably all going, who? And
are you sure that's a guy?
Yeah. Well, he was born Joseph Niépce, but for whatever reason, changed his name to Nicéphore.
Oh.
And so he died July 5th, 1833, but about 10 years, a little less than that, maybe 8 years before his passing, he took what is credited by many to be the first photograph that had some kind of permanence to it. And the title of the photo, it's a very blurry, grainy, but it's the first that was shot 1825, 1826. They find it hard to pinpoint. But he apparently he had to expose his image for 8 hours to get it to work. And so he just set his early version of the camera up, pointed out his window, and it's a picture of a rooftop in France. I think it's actually Paris, but I don't recall. But so he built upon the idea of some sort of permanence method, and he's considered the inventor of heliography, which is one of the first processes. So, and that got us talking about some things that that the 180 years ago was kind of the history of modern or the start of modern photography. And what did we think were major events in the history of photography in the last 180 years? So if we start back in 1825, 1825, 1826, with Niépce creating the first permanent image, where do we go from there? And when I looked into some of these things, one of the first was, and for like the first almost 30 years or so, all of the big events were all related to technology, kind of like today in digital. It was going from, you know, someone creating one new process to the other. 1834, a fellow by the name of Henry Fox Talbot.
There you go.
Yeah. He created the first permanent negative, and he used a piece of paper that had been soaked in sodium chloride and fixed in a salt solution. And so that was considered, he created the first positive image, and as opposed to the other ones where you had to contact print them onto a piece of paper. So that's kind of interesting. From there, 1837, we go to Louis Daguerre, who started creating images on silver-plated copper and daguerreotypes. And this was it was coated with silver iodine. So we're starting to get into a more permanent process. We're using silver for the first time. And it was, now, this is the good part. You and I were laughing about this a week or so ago. It was developed in mercury vapors.
Yeah.
Nothing like smelling mercury for a few hours to really get your brain cells going. So photography in the early days wasn't for the weak of heart or weak of mind.
Very, very dangerous.
Yeah. Very toxic chemicals, many of them used, iodine, mercury. These are things that, we tend to stay away from today, but it is what it is. In 41, Talbot patented his process under, and it was called a calotype. And that was a big step forward. In 1851, this is a little known, most people don't recognize this name, Frederick Scott Archer. He was English, and he created the first, he improved on photographic resolution and everything, because what he was working on was spreading a mixture of collodion, which is nitrated cotton dissolved in ether and alcohol. That sounds fun. Nothing like being in a dark room with a bunch of ether. Gee, I passed out. Oh, well, I'm dead. He was coating this onto sheets of glass, and it was called the wet plate collodion process. And the advantage there was using the glass plates as opposed to copper. It was a much more economical process than the daguerreotypes and the negative-positive process going on. So Archer basically gave it away. He published the process but never patented. So that started a lot of inventors working with putting different types of what we now term emulsions onto
glass.
And so it was Archer that kind of just threw it out there into the public. And then in the 1850s, we had photographers opening up their first portrait studios in Paris, and, led to worldwide things. And I'm starting to move through some of these because I want to get up to 1861. Scottish physicist James Clerk Maxwell basically demonstrated the first color photography. 1861, and it's I've seen a image of that, but it's was more done by shooting it through three different colored filters. He did red, green, and blue, which was actually the predecessor of almost like Technicolor, because that's how early motion picture film was done in color, was shooting it through different filters. He produced what was known back then as a lantern slide, which was this glass plate that you put into what they termed a magic lantern. Well, that's where that term came from. And it projected an image onto a screen or onto the wall.
What we'd have called a slide projector.
Yeah. Today we would know it as a slide projector. And the projector had the three filters already in it, so that's what provided the color. And then this week being the 150th anniversary of the Battle at Gettysburg, 1861, 1865 brought about Matthew Brady. And I know you've got some comments on that.
Well, Matthew Brady had a great number of negatives that they shot.
Thousands. Yeah.
And most of the photographs, they're attributed to Matthew Brady, but he had a lot of different photographers shooting for him.
Basically a staff of photographers
shooting.
Yeah.
And he really was the owner of a studio, so to speak, and he put his name on just about everything.
Yeah. They were all basically work for hire. They were all his
staff.
Images and his staff. Yeah.
For the first time, you started to see, after that Civil War and thousands of images, you started to see the growth of photography.
Right.
To shortly thereafter, the Congress sends famous photographers that we know today, O'Sullivan, Jackson, and sends them out to the West for some just phenomenal photographs that came back. And you started to see that for the first time in history, people could be sitting in their home in Ohio or Pennsylvania or New York or wherever,
right,
and start to see what the rest of the world looked like if they'd never been there.
All right. And the chances of them having been there, railroads didn't cross the country yet. The Transcontinental Railroad wasn't built, 1870. But getting back to that period right before that, the Civil War period, that brought about something that really, there were pictures taken of prior wars. And the 1850s, I think it was the Crimean War.
Yep.
And the photographers were told, you know, to make these images look real, almost romantic, that there was still this
heroic romantic
efforts and things, and war was something that was had this great honor about it and all these things, and kept it pretty clean. And for the first time, Brady's pictures, partly because the photographic process at that time still required, even in good light, minutes to make a proper exposure, nothing like the 8 hours that Niepce had to experience. There wasn't much, you know, people had to be braced in metal braces so their head didn't turn. That wasn't too practical on a battlefield. So what Brady and mostly his staff photographed were a lot of the aftermath.
Yep.
And for the first time, people were seeing images of dead soldiers, and it didn't look quite so romantic and heroic anymore. But that was the start, and much of the innovation we saw for the next 100 years was due to photographers in war situations, and we'll talk about that as we progress down the timeline here. But, yeah, 1870, and, you know, there's a great show going on right now, a photographic show at the St. Petersburg Museum of Photographic Arts. We're going there in a couple of it might even be this coming. No, not this Saturday. I think the following Saturday, the 20th. It is about early photographs in our national parks.
Oh, yeah.
And a great show at the St. Petersburg Museum of Fine Arts. And we're going there. I think it's July 20th, I think, is the date the Florida Center for Creative Photography is going. But, so, yeah, 1870 saw Jackson and O'Sullivan going out west, and early efforts. I mean, Congress paid for that, and they brought back pictures of Yellowstone, and national parks weren't even created at that point. It was 1872 that Yellowstone, our first national park, the world's first national park, was created. So we progress a few years past there, and this is one that Ted thought was a real game changer, this particular image. This fellow goes by two names, Edward Muggeridge, English photographer, yep. But he eventually changed his name to Edward Muybridge. The famous photograph of, does a horse get all four hooves off the ground? And the answer, of course, was yes. He had developed a process to do effectively the first time-lapse photography,
yep,
and answer that question. And so now photography was being used for, you know, of course, this one was to settle a bet. But it could be used for technical, scientific research, evaluation. And so photography was really now entering into a new era and a new path by that simple demonstration of what could be done. And then things started to change pretty quickly there. About that same time, dry plates, the first dry plates were being sold commercially, mostly in New York City or large European cities, Paris, London. But it was becoming a commercial activity. And it was 2 years later in 1880 when George Eastman started his company, the Eastman Dry Plate Company in Rochester, New York. And that same year, the first photograph was published in a newspaper, coincidentally enough. But if you followed much of Eastman, that was quite an interesting life. We've got a documentary on him that I've showed a couple times at our monthly meetings, and I may do one of those again on Eastman. There's some great stuff out on him. But he worked out of his mother's kitchen cooking at night. The process had become a little more user-friendly, not quite so much mercury and iodine and ether, but trying to perfect his own emulsion. And a year later, or actually several years later, was the late 80s, he produced effectively his first camera. But rather than using film, it used photographic paper. And it held 100 shots. And you would, you know, after you shot it, you would send the camera back to Kodak, and they would process it and send you back another camera with
100 shots
another 100 shots to go. And so it was quite a innovative thing that he got involved in, and that was the start of the Great Eastman Kodak Company for the next 100-plus years. But it only took them a year. Year later, they improved that camera, and instead of paper,
they were using film. Yep.
Yeah.
And that was a big breakthrough.
It was, from many standpoints. The ability to have additional prints made easily because now
there was a negative.
You had a negative, yeah.
Yep.
And as expensive as it was, even at that era, still, the convenience factor opened it up to more and more people.
Yes.
And we have a wider documentation of what was going on in the world. And everything from the mundane to the exotic was starting to be documented photographically. And it was only about a year later that this was 1890. Jacob Riss published a book entitled How the Other Half Lives.
Oh, yeah.
And these were images of tenement life in New York City. And we were now starting to see photography being used to really document the human condition. And the original, 10 years after that, 1900, turn of the century, the Kodak Brownie box roll film camera was introduced, the first Brownie. And I can remember in the camera industry, not early Brownies, but we're looking at cameras from the 1915, 1920s, these folding cameras.
Oh, yeah, sure. And Kodak folding cameras with roll film.
Yeah. And 828 and 626, a bunch of 818, there were a bunch of these films that, of course, were basically no longer made. But I can remember so many times people would come in to camera store thinking that they had this rare find, and they were going to be
collectible camera.
Yeah, and
I'm sorry, Kodak made too many of them. It's worth $5.
yeah, and that's on a good day if yours was in good condition. And it'd be funny, these guys would walk in with this thing, and you know, we'd talk to them a little bit about it, and we'd say how neat it was. And did you know it came in a whole bunch of different colors?
Oh, yeah.
And we'd go, yeah, there were red ones and green. Here, look up on our wall. And we had about 25 of these things set up there. And, you know, I'd have to tell the poor guy, yeah, it's worth about $5. Yeah. You and everybody else's grandmother had one, and you just found it in the basement. I know.
Yeah.
Been there, done that. And
Yeah.
Yeah, so that was kind of interesting. So
if it is a colored one, it's worth $2 more.
That's actually true. Kodak literally about made a million of them. Not quite, but they
were in, relatively speaking, mass production. And, you know, so many families had their Kodak.
Yeah. Absolutely. And there were different generations, but there were just minor improvements in viewfinders and lenses and shutters and things.
Yeah.
The next big thing in photography, 1902, Alfred Stieglitz organized what he called the Photo Secessionists. And they had their first show in New York City. And this was a huge, huge change for photography. And it was the starting, with Stieglitz starting to really get into this and promoting photography in major ways in New York and around the world. He traveled to Europe, which was popular at the time. he was changing what was the pictorialist movement was about to change. And the pictorialist movement was the manipulation of the negatives and the prints and turning them into something that more closely resembled a painting than a Matthew Brady photograph. And we had during the late 1800s, we had kind of separated where photography, if it was to be art, needed to mimic painting. And the technical side of it, you know, the early days of photojournalism was photography had to be, you know, factual, this realism involved. But photography is an art form. You needed to make it look like a painting. And this was the start of manipulation. No Photoshop, no nothing, computer-wise, of course, but use of different chemicals, different processing techniques, actually working on the negative, doing little techniques to alter the negative to get the look of the images. And so Stiglitz hadn't really formed his movement yet, but the photo secessionists was the first attempt to start to move away towards pictorialism. And someone who you're quite fond of, you loaned Teresa a book.
Oh, Edward S. Curtis.
Yeah, 1906, J.P. Morgan financed Edward Curtis to document the traditional culture of North American Indians.
And when you look at his images,
yep,
they are a mixture of the two.
Right.
They're sharp, they're crisp, they're not manipulated, but many of them are highly posed.
Right.
Rather than capturing, you know, candid type photography that we have kind of moved to with photojournalism and things like that, you know, his were all highly posed. And yet still have that most of the time that sharpness that we expect later on.
Yeah, which we get to when we talk about Adams and F-64 in that little bit. But and again, the start of this glimpse of starting. I mean, it was twofold. One, it was documenting.
Yep.
You know, Morgan recognized that. Things were changing, and photography was a valid means of documenting and preserving for future generations what's going to be lost.
Yep.
And that was a major, major breakthrough that he would actually, I mean, it was like a work for hire, a commission to go do this. And
he spent most of his life doing that when J.P. Morgan's money ran out.
Yeah. Well, but he achieved some commercial success.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, he did.
With his work. Yeah.
The National Geographic also backed it.
Yeah, in the early days of National Geo, yeah, absolutely. 1907, we saw the first commercial color film. So even though we had produced color images through use of filters and things like that, well, it wasn't until 1907 that the first color film, what was called autochrome, was manufactured and by the Lumiere brothers of France, of all places. So you can see that you know, we think of photography as maybe an American thing, but that's our pretty biased American mindset on these things.
Yeah, Kodak did not invent everything.
yeah, thank God. That a lot of the early innovation was coming out of Europe.
Oh, yeah.
And a lot of the artistic movements, you know, that influenced Stiglitz, who influenced photography in North America and the United States, you know, was drawing heavily on things going on in Europe at that time. And then here is one. Now, this is, you know, when you know, we're leading up to a series that we're going to start doing here about game-changing, world-changing photographs. 1909, Lewis Hine was hired by the U.S. National Child Labor Committee to photograph working conditions the children were in. And those were some of the most stirring images that, again, started to change America. There's a picture that two of them that sit strongly in my mind. One is a little girl in front of a
huge loom.
Yeah, I guess it would be a loom would be accurate, in like South Carolina.
Yeah.
The girl's probably 7 or 8 years old and working in a factory. The other is, the title of the picture is The Breaker Boys.
Oh, yeah.
And it's kids that are probably preteen, and their job was to break up big clumps of coal to get the mud and the dirt and stuff off of them and get to the coal. And it woke up America that maybe kids need to be in school and shouldn't be working in hazardous jobs and losing their lives. And Hines spent, you know, almost the rest of his life documenting workers' conditions and things, and pretty much died penniless. But his images changed the United States.
Absolutely.
And, was really responsible for a lot of the early child labor laws. And the start of that was 1909. A few years later, about the time of the outbreak of World War One, a fellow by the name of, you'll recognize this name, Oscar Barnack.
Oh, yes.
He got hired by a German optical company, microscope maker, Leitz.
Mm-hmm.
And he started playing around. He developed a camera that was using what they then considered a miniature format, mm-hmm. but it used the 24 by 36 millimeter frame that we know today as 35 millimeter film.
Right, which at the time was used for cinematography.
Right.
And he adapted that to use it in a small still camera.
Right. Yeah, he took 35 millimeter motion picture film, which at that time was the standard, and it had the sprocket holes in it. That's how it advanced through the movie camera.
Right.
Whether, you know, in the early days it was hand cranked.
Right.
And then they quickly automated that.
And most other still film at the time, they didn't advance with sprockets.
Yeah, it was all sheet film.
It was all sheet film. Or in the Kodaks, yep. It just wound with the paper backing.
Yeah, it was a pressure.
Yeah.
Pressure advance, basically. Because once you got it caught, you're just pulling it through.
You just, yeah.
Yep. So this was a new innovation. No camera yet, but this was the start of what we would then for the next 80, 90 years, be a major format. The parent company, the early company of Nikon, Nippon Kogoku, was founded in 1917, and one of the very first Japanese optical camera companies was founded. That was 1917. So they're coming up on 100th anniversary here pretty soon. That'll be interesting to see what Nikon does for that. And one of the early photographers that I enjoy his work a lot, some people find it a little strange, but a fellow by the name of Man Ray.
Man Ray, absolutely, I enjoy it.
Yeah.
Rayographs.
Yep. Started making what were generically known as photograms, and he called them rayographs. And basically he set objects on photographic paper and exposed the shadows and light and everything and to a light bulb. And that was pretty cool stuff. So that was a new type of thing. And there, you know, a lot of stuff. That was the Bauhaus movement in Germany, the whole architectural style of things.
And I think he was Hungarian, if I remember.
Probably. There are several early Hungarians. Robert Capa was Hungarian. Cortez was Hungarian. The European influence. Early 1921, 20s. And a few years later, 1924, Leica marketed the first miniature 35 millimeter camera.
The first Leica.
Yep, known as Leica. So that's coming up on an anniversary, too. We'll be 90 years into it next year. That'll be interesting to see what Leica and some of these companies do in the next few years. And 1925, I just mentioned them, André Cortez.
Mm-hmm.
Moved from Hungary to Paris, and he began a about a decade-long project of documenting life in the streets of Paris.
Yep.
And quite a new genre, but again, building on that tradition of photographing everyday life as it happens. And Cortez is was quite an innovator. You know, and he felt slighted in his life that Bresson got a lot more attention and notice, particularly in the United States.
Yep.
Cortez was pretty well known in Europe.
In Europe, but not here.
But and he felt part of it was the reason he never got the acceptance and recognition that he was owed in the United States was he had a heavy, heavy accent and felt that that was one of the things
that held him back.
Held him back, yeah.
Not on your list there, I don't think, but somebody in that time frame that I particularly appreciate was Paul Strand.
Oh, yeah. Strand was one of the ones who influenced Stieglitz in definitely moving away from the pictorialist movement. Paul Strand's another one. I've got a documentary on him, too. And something like, I think it's called Out of the Darkness or something. Mm-hmm. But very influential. He influenced Ansel Adams. And Strand has some iconic images from the from 1910 to 1930, probably.
Yep.
And he was published several times. Probably, I think he was the most published photographer in Stieglitz's journals that he published. And quite an innovative guy there, yeah. And then moving on, 1931, and this is a guy that I admire a lot, was the development of electronic flash or strobe photography. Harold Doc Edgerton at MIT did all of the early work on strobe photography and continued he was quite an inventor. The other thing that he's little known for, but he's the inventor of side-scanning sonar and a lot of things. He did a lot of work in World War II for the Allies, and Doc was something. But, of course, some iconic images are credited to him. The picture of the bullet going through an apple, going through a playing card, going through a balloon.
Light bulb,
you pick it. Old Doc Edgerton was quite a guy and played around with photography. And we were talking about this a month or so ago. I said, do you know how he triggered that and how they got the timing of the bullet just when it's going through, you know, the apple? And what they did was he used a sound trigger. And so when they fired the bullet, the microphone would hear it and send a signal to the camera, and they would develop the piece of film and look at it, and then they'd go, oh, the bullet hadn't gone through the card or was too soon or whatever, too late. And so he would adjust the distance of the microphone to the pistol to get the right release. The closer it was, the sound would hit the microphone earlier and trigger the camera earlier. So, you know, you'd think they had some high-tech kind of thing.
Right. Would think you'd use light somehow with today's technology because it's basically instantaneous at small distances, but no.
No, they use sound in a microphone. So,
which was still pretty creative.
Yeah, it was. Leave it to Doc. That was 1931. 1932 was, and this what started, you know, started really fueling a company like Kodak, was the inception of Technicolor for movies. And so now we had a way of combining black and white negatives made in the same camera but under different filters. This is going back to that early color attempt. And Technicolor. So we now had color motion picture films. And in a few years, we'd see movies like Gone with the Wind and things like that. You probably remember those. You probably were in the theater waiting for movies to go
color. Well, same thing with sound. You know, it's not the topic, but holy mackerel, that little mouse is talking.
Well, you were there for that matinee, weren't you? Yeah, I thought so.
Yeah, Dave and I used to go to all the matinees.
Yeah, that's right. 1920-something.
You got to stay home with Mom and Dad.
Yeah, yeah. You're still missing, but that's okay. Also, that same year, 1932, is a change in photography. We're going to see a new, younger group of photographers start to dominate American photography for the next 50 years. And Ansel Adams, Imogene Cunningham, who we talked about last mm-hmm. week, she was This Week in Photography, fellow by the name of Willard Van Dyke, Edward Weston, and several others formed a photography group called F64, because that was one of the f-stops on a large format camera. And typically, one, it was considered probably your sharpest aperture. And they brought about what was known as straight photographic thought and production. And this was a change. Pictorialism was finally dead. It really was in its last days after World War One, because of the documentary work that went on there. But Adams and Weston's group really kind of finished it off. Yep. And ushered in a new era, straight photography. But that's a term that many beginners or people that don't know photographic history, they misunderstand. And they think that Adams and these guys, straight photography, that meant like straight out of camera, that they made that picture in their camera and they printed it,
yeah.
And that was a straight photograph.
Yeah, like an 8x10 contact print.
Right. And the reality of that was that's 100% false.
Yeah, well.
And they got into extensive manipulation. Adams at times would spend 4 or 5 hours in the darkroom working on a single print.
Yeah, which takes a few seconds on a straight print.
Right.
You know, for anybody that doesn't know what a contact print is, that means you have what's known as a contact printer, which sends light up, and you put your sheet of paper on the contact printer. You set the negative on top of it.
Right.
You close it.
Put a glass cover on it.
Put a glass cover on it. And expose it to light, and there is the straight contact print.
Right, right. And, and Adams didn't do that, nor did Weston or the rest of these guys. They were concerned in making art, and art took a distinct turn at this point. You're now heavily, heavily manipulating them, but to a degree of realism. These photographers were trying to make film and paper capture the mental images that they took back. What they saw before them couldn't be reproduced on paper and film, and it took this heavy darkroom manipulation to truly realize...
Yeah. To reproduce what they saw.
Yes, yep, in their mind's eye. So that was 32. A couple other things happened that year. Henri Cartier-Bresson bought his first Leica, and for the next 60 years, he photographed people and things. And the term, while he never said it, attributed to him the decisive moment. That it's all about capturing the peak action. And using his miniature camera, his 35mm, he was able to do that.
Yeah.
And so that was 32. And another one, same year, George Eastman, who had developed, he was quite sick at that point. He was 77 years old, committed suicide. Shot himself in his home.
Yeah.
He had the same degenerative, I think it was like a bone disease that his mother had, and saw the pain and everything that she had gone through and decided he would end it all. So that was 1932. Several others, Brassailles, a French photographer, he published his first book on Paris. It was kind of risque. It had a lot of dancers, had some prostitutes, some nudity in it and things. But this was Paris and Europe in the 30s getting ready for the war. 1934, Fujifilm was founded. And in 1938, they produced their first cameras. So this is all pre-World War II, Fuji starting to become a powerhouse. But the United States was in the midst of a depression. And out of that comes some historical kind of partnership.
Yep.
Which is the FSA, the Farm Security Administration, hiring photographers to document the condition during the Depression. And this provided income for some of the great photographers of the 20th century. And thinking of Walker Evans, Dorothea Lange, Arthur Rothstein, even Ansel Adams got in on it. There were just a number of photographers that worked on projects for the FSA.
Yep.
And many of these, well, all of the images, while they were on the government payroll, they're in the public domain.
Yep.
And the Library of Congress has some, but they're split around through several resources. The National Park Service has some, the ones that were documented, the parks and things. So that created a tremendous storehouse or wealth of imagery from the 30s and the Depression. And again, pictures, Migrant Mother by Dorothea yep. Lange, changed
Iconic.
The way
yep.
that we thought about helping people during that time. And Roosevelt was able to get his deals passed, the New Deal and all these things, to help alleviate and improve the human condition. 1936, we've got a phone call in a minute. I'll run through this one simply because it ties into our theme song, and we'll see how much time we end up. It may be our swan song, too. But 1936 was the development of Kodachrome, which was the first color, multi-layered color film, and also at the same time, the Exacta camera in 1936, which was a pioneering 35-millimeter SLR.
First 35-millimeter single-lens reflex, and the Kodachrome was developed by two high school chemistry students.
Yep.
That somehow got in contact with Kodak, and Kodak says, we're going to hire you, and we're going to finish this off.
Yep. And what I always found interesting, the names of these two guys, I had to quick Wikipedia this, but it's interesting. Can I find him real quick? No, I can't, so I'm not going to worry about it. Let's go to our phone call.
Okay.
We've got John on the line. Hey, John.
Yes. I just want to tell you, I travel up to Tampa on Friday, Saturdays and Sundays, and I'm a driver.
Sure.
And for LabCorp, and I want to tell you how interesting your program is.
Well, thank you.
I love history, and the way that you present this information is truly extraordinary, and I just wanted you to know that I appreciate it. And I appreciate 1340 for having you on.
Well, great. John, thanks. Keep
John,
listening.
We appreciate that.
Yep. Tell your friends.
I will.
All righty.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank
Have
you.
A great evening, John. Take care.
Thank you.
So let me see if I can find those guys' names about Kodachrome. But did, Leopold Godowski
yep.
and Leopold Mainz
mm-hmm.
Were the two inventors. So if you want to invent film, it would help if your first name were Leopold.
Right.
Yep. I think I'll name my first kid that, Leopold. We'll see where that goes. Anyway, we got a few more minutes here. We'll see if we can get through World War II, so to speak. And so that was 36, and then World War II. Hitler started doing his number on Europe, and of course, mass migrations, people trying to leave the areas. But World War II brought about a couple things. War efforts. Color negatives were invented basically as a result of the war effort. The U.S. government wanted color imagery, and millions of dollars were poured into developing that. And the latter part of the war was used extensively. Even the History Channel does the World at War in color and you start to finally see some of this stuff. But it really changed a number of things. Photographers, for the first time, were really allowed in combat. They accompanied the troops, and we've talked about this before.
Yep.
Robert Capa on D-Day in the LSTs, making the landings with the Marines and the soldiers going in on the Normandy beaches. People had never seen anything like that before. Margaret Bourke White, a woman photographer, going into Russia and documenting some of that, documenting the internment camps. We talked about that a couple of weeks ago.
Yep.
And what a change. You know, for the first time, people saw the horror of what Hitler did in Europe, in Eastern Europe, and woke people up to things. W. Eugene Smith and all of those people, Bourke White, Robert Capa, W. Eugene Smith, they covered the war for Life magazine. Life was bringing the horrors of war into people's living rooms on a weekly basis. And the war effort, you know, the typical, you know, make a poster, make everybody feel good, bond drives, very patriotic. They were also seeing a lot of the horror of war as well, and that sons and daughters and neighbors and such were
in the middle of it.
We're in the middle of it, and many of them dying. And yeah, some of the, you know, because our dad was in the Pacific,
yep.
And that's where W. Eugene Smith ended up. Saipan and Iwo Jima and Okinawa. Those are amazing images to look at today. And of course, Eugene Smith was known as not the nicest guy to work
in the world.
With. Yeah. None of the editors at any of the magazines cared for him at all.
But boy, talk about a photographer.
Yeah, the photographer's photographer. So the war ended in 1947. Fellow by the name of Robert Capa, Hungarian, Henri Cartier-Bresson. And David Seymour. David Seymour had a nickname, like Chum or something like that. I can't remember his nickname. But they started the very first photographer-owned photo agency, Magnum. Where when you joined it, you had to be accepted, but you became effectively a partner.
Yeah. They basically asked you to join,
yeah.
And then you became a partner.
Yeah. And of all things, W. Eugene Smith... I think he was the first and only partner asked to leave. poor Eugene, but I seem to recall that. But that was 47, and so now we're going to see photographers take more control of their imagery, and Magnum lives on today. Some of the world's greatest photographers work for Magnum. But things are still starting to change. Post-war... Europe's coming back. Japan's coming back. 1948, Hasselblad in Sweden releases their first medium format SLR. And Pentax, at the same time in Japan, introduced the first automatic diaphragm camera. Before, everything was stopped down. You might have had a reflex mirror, but yep. The diaphragm wasn't automatic. So now things are...
They had something to do, I think, with an instant return mirror too.
Yeah, yeah, I
one
think
of the
so.
First instant return mirror.
Yep. And of all things, 1948, Polaroid sells their first pack of instant black and white film. So now a new era, instant photography is a buzzword. 49. After the war, Germany got split in two. And part of Carl Zeiss ended up in West Germany. Part of the Carl Zeiss company ended up in East Germany. And the East German Zeiss company developed the Contax X-S, which was the first SLR with an unreversed image. They used a pentaprism for the first time. So as you look through the viewfinder, the image wasn't upside down or reversed left to right. You could actually see it in the correct orientation.
Yeah, that was a real groundbreaking camera.
Yeah.
It set the blueprint that the Japanese looked at for how a 35 SLR should work.
Yeah. And it wasn't long until they figured it out because Nikon in the late 50s, of course, would produce their first F camera. Prior to that, they're all rangefinders. And this is what we'll end up on tonight. Edward Steichen curated the Family of Man exhibit at the New York Museum of Modern Art. And that's probably considered the greatest photographic exhibition ever created. It traveled around the world. It's got a permanent home now in Europe. I think it might be Brussels, but I wouldn't swear to that. And Steichen was basically handpicked to be the curator of the Museum of Modern Art, and greatly influenced American photography for 30 years, from the 50s to, you know, when he finally left and appointed John Sarkowski. So really, the direction of photography was guided by a handful of men for 90 years, thereabouts, and is still kind of manipulated that way. But it's about time to go. So we got through not quite 100 years, well, a little over 100 years, if we go back to 1825, 1826. I think that was the year you graduated from high school. Gail, we didn't get to your question and a couple of others, and we'll try to make our best efforts to get you emailed and post some answers on those things. We've only got a short time, so we'll finish this up next week.
Yep.
We've got that. And we're leading up to where we're going to talk about some specific photographs on the show, but yep. thought maybe a little background in photography would help people understand where we're at today and how we got here and maybe where we're going in the next 100 years of photography.
Yep.
So we've got a few seconds left, but lots of things going on at the Florida Center for Creative Photography. Check us out this week and come to one of our many, many, many free events. We hope to see you on a photo walk. And Lou, it's been fun tonight.
Absolutely. It always is.
Yep. And listeners, thanks for joining us. Cedric, thank you for being in the control booth. And for Lou Donald, this is Jeff Donald signing off. Have a great evening and go out and take some pictures, but not tonight in the rain. Good night, all.